So again, hello everyone to the SAP community call on the UI5 tooling and ecosystem. My name is Svea Becker and I'm your host today. And with me is Peter Müßig as well as Margaret Wolny. Peter is leading through the presentation today. He is the chief architect for SAP UI5 and he is one of the initiators who started the Phoenix project, which is also known as Open UI5 or SAP UI5. He started this in 2009, as well as other known products and technologies like SAP Web IDE, or UI5 Web Components. And I'm really happy that you're here with me today, Peter and Margot. Margot will also assist in answering your questions, which already started. Yeah, well, and I would say I give a short introduction to the Zoom and then we can start right away. So if you hover below, you can see the black menu, or it could also be in the top of your window. And there you have the chance to have the chat window open on the right-hand side and to interact with us a little bit, or you can also ask questions here. Of course, we record the session and the session, the recording will be available afterwards. I will post the link here as well. And everyone is unmuted, as I said, but later on you can raise your hand when you go to your name and then I can unmute you and we can speak a little bit if we have the time for it. So I stop here and hand over to Peter and we will close also now the videos because then you are not distracted by our nice pictures. So go ahead, Peter.
Okay, thanks, Svea. Thanks for the introduction. Thanks for having us today and the chance to talk about the tooling. So with that, to not spend too much time, I stop now the video and go directly in the session. So we have prepared plenty of material for today and some of things might be known already to you. I hope the audio quality is good today. We are all from home office. So let's start with the tooling. And first of all, I want to mention one thing. Development efficiency is key. So for me, it's very important that the development efficiency of my environment is good and that I can fastly do things and get the results immediately on the screen. And so this is also one thing which drives me when looking on the tooling perspective to enable that exactly for us as UI5 developers. So the UI5 tooling, it's quite a while since we started to announce the UI5 tooling with the Node.js variant. So we had in the past the tooling internally developed as a Maven tooling, which never made it public. Unfortunately, it was good that time, but nowadays we would go to the JavaScript world for sure. And that's why we have this Node.js tooling. And that's why we decided after the experience with Grunt on Open UI5 to go for a real Node.js variant of a tooling, which is now developed purely as open source. And this is now also one thing which is a novum that all the projects we start right now with a community drive, that they are open source available. The basic idea behind the tooling is that it's really modular, it's configurable and extensible. And it's based on a command line interface, which is especially tailored to help us to develop applications, libraries, and reuse components. And with that, I start to go a bit more in detail to explain the motivation behind that. The motivation of the tooling is really something that we want to increase for sure developer experience. I mentioned this initially, it's key. To get really every one of us into a really efficient environment. And for that, what we need to and want to do is to reuse, especially open source tooling for that. We reuse a lot of the open source tooling already for the UI5 tooling, internally, be it in the middleware, the Express, or be it other parts there. So we want to have it flexible and extensible, which means that we can easily embed it into environments like build server via CLI interface. Or if you have a Grunt Gulp environment, we also provide a nice JavaScript API, which allows you to integrate the tooling as well in these environments. It's basically easy to integrate as said via these different options. And we want to also strive for one other part. We want to enable modern language features. So UI5 itself, as we developed it, it's a bit, I'd say it's a bit gray at the moment already. So basically having ES5 features and developing on that. And what you have seen in the JavaScript ecosystem is that it mainly goes forward and it has features like Babel and stuff like that around available, which helps it to use modern language features already during development. And we also want to open us that way. And this tooling is one of the key pieces to open us for that. And another thing which is also great with this new CLI-based tooling is that it's not integrated, for example, like other tools, maybe to a specific IDE. We really strive now forward to have this command line interface. This can be easily integrated in a web IDE. It can be easily integrated in a visual or used in a Visual Studio code. It can be used somewhere else as well. So from an architectural perspective, how the tooling is being created and built up is that we are mainly focused on this command line interface. The command line interface is using several modules. So we have here, for example, in the tooling implemented things like the file system module, which is doing some kind of an abstraction on how the resources are stored in the file system and make them available for the tooling internally when you are working with that. For example, by building a task or a middleware on your own, that you have the runtime path available to find the resources. So it bridges the gap between design time and runtime perspective. There is also things available like, for example, this project module, which makes it possible to, or which is the bridge to understand what are dependencies, what are local resources, to bring them together with the file system. It makes it accessible for the UI5 tooling, for the server and the builder at the end, that these resources can be used for building or for serving in the middleware. So the logon, just some convenience that we have a logger API available internally. And if you are developing custom tasks or middlewares, if you have done it already, you should also use this logger to log your information for that. And then the two most important parts of the UI5 CLI tooling is these modules around the server and the builder. And SUI5 itself, this tooling is built at type-based and task-centric. We have some specific project types, and these project types, they are assigned to specific tasks. And these tasks, they are used in the builder at the end to build your project. And in the middleware, we also included for a fast preview, specific middlewares, which do, for example, things like copyright replacement, version replacement, theme builds on the fly and stuff like that during the development time to avoid long build turnarounds while developing. So these middlewares and tasks, they can are provided by for sure by our tooling, but they can also be provided as simple NPM modules somewhere else. And also from NPM, we also fetch dependencies to UI5, be it open UI5 or sub UI5. So there is one other channel which we have, and this is for sure, if you are running the development mode, we see that later on, then you have a web browser which you can use to access to the development server your project. So overall, the CLI is not only used locally for development, it can also be nowadays used in the sub-web IDE. It's used for the building already today, but not for the preview. And it can be used also in the sub-business application studio or any other editor of choice. So from a project types perspective, we basically support around four project types in the UI5 CLI. Most of you might have, if you're already working with the UI5 CLI tooling, would have developed applications. So it's at the end, it's a component which is used as a starting point when starting up the application. It comes with, some stuff like the index.html, the manifest.json, the component.js as some basic requirements, and the development server can be used to then launch the application. We have also things like libraries, which can be developed with that. It's mainly used by us from sub-UI5 or open-UI5 perspective to provide our control libraries, but you can also use that to develop your own control libraries for sure or reuse components. Other types are a theme library, which is especially something if you develop a custom theme, then this library type can be used to put just the custom theme stuff inside. And a very primitive type is the module type. So with a module type, for example, there are no specific tasks of the UI5 CLI assigned. And it's a very free project at the end, which can be used to do a complete different build for your custom module at the end. So let's look a bit into the prerequisite and installation. So as a prerequisite of the UI5 CLI, it requires node 10 or higher. NPM, a node-based package manager at the end, be it NPM or Yarn or whatever for the dependencies. To install it, it's a very simple command. To install it globally, you run npm install --global at UI5 CLI. And this ensures to install the UI5 CLI on your machine globally. And afterwards, you can do a UI5 help to really validate whether the command is already working properly. So if you have done that, there is also a nice documentation available, online documentation. You can go to, it's the UI5 CLI, it's subgithub.com/UI5-tooling. And there you find documentation for that. It's explaining a lot of things what I already do today also, and in much more detail than I do it, you know. So from a tooling perspective, let's look into such a project, a UI5 tooling project. Let's go into a UI5 app. So I created a very primitive one here. This is a pure node project, let's say. There's a package JSON inside, and we have a web app folder where the UI5 resources could be contained in. And if you have such a basic project which has not been enabled for the UI5 tooling already, you can use now the globally installed UI5 CLI to init this project. And when doing this UI5 init, then it creates for you a UI5 YAML file with a dedicated content. So I see now in my directory, the UI5 YAML is being created. And with this UI5 YAML file, I have now already the metadata for the UI5 tooling available, which is basically necessary here to use the UI5 CLI tooling. It knows here this is a type application. This is derived from the existence of a web app folder when initializing it. And it also detects the name from that. And the spec version is used for the UI5 tooling to validate here the content of the UI5 YAML file. So going back to the presentation, so the must contain parts we have seen, it must contain this project name, it must contain the project type and the specification versions. So these are basic parts of that. And it allows a definition of other things as well. So if the project is different than a standard project, like for example, not having a web app folder, and it's maybe an app folder, you can also change it via configuration to do a proper path mapping for that, or things like file encoding for properties files and so on. There is much more. I would not go in detail yet. Something maybe you can also read then in the documentation part. At the end, the UI5 YAML file also contains more information. So we see that later on in the demo for the custom tasks and custom middlewares, that there you can put also extension configuration about additional builder steps or additional server middlewares. And they are all located in this UI5 YAML file. And that's one other thing, the build configuration. So if you needed a special bundling, but this is also worth then maybe a complete separate session to explain custom bundling and how that is working, that we maybe do that separately, or even provide some more information on that separately, because you can really specify and configure the UI5 tooling, how the bundles are being built, what to be included, what not, and you can split up and optimize the loading of a UI5 application with that. So let's demo it, the tooling, for those who have not seen it yet. So let's clone the Open UI5 application, https://github.com/sap/openui5sample. I should have copied that, but it's now okay. So, and after cloning the project, the first thing what we do is to run npm install. So maybe I don't know whether you also see this coming in. So the first thing is to really ensure that the dependencies are properly downloaded. And this is a typical thing you do for sure on this npm projects. And once npm install is done, should be done in a second. So it has hopefully not too many dependencies. So I tried it before. then you can use the tooling. So you can now start the development server of the tooling here by using UI5 serve. And if you put, for example, the command, the argument -o index.html with that, it immediately also starts the browser for you. So you don't need to open the browser and enter that. And now I see that the application is running really in the development mode. So this is the OpenUI5 sample application. And that's basically it to add the development server. Now I can start working on that, can modify that and refresh the app here to see my changes. So this is the UI5 serve command, and it's more or less doing one thing. Maybe let's go briefly back to that and spend a little bit more time on that to see one thing, because in the UI5 serve command, you have also the functionality of listing dependencies or listing the resources which are available here. So, and here you should also take a look into the last column. In the last column, you see from which project it's being loaded. OpenUI5 sample app means this is my local project and it's coming from the web app folder. And there is another thing like this resources, and these resources you see at OpenUI5 sub UI core or at OpenUI5 sub M or somewhere else. So it mentions which project is finally providing this resource for us. And the UI5 project module plus the file system module now provides access to that in the middleware. And so looking into this project setup, we see in the package JSON, there are these dependencies to the OpenUI5 libraries, and the UI5 server is more or less providing or giving me access to that in the middleware, and so I can use them locally. So, and unfortunately, this kind of stuff is at the moment with the current 1.0 version of the tooling only available for OpenUI5. But also there is something more in a second. So besides that, you can build the application, and there is a UI5 build command. Let's go into the help, where you can have two different modes to build it. You have the preload build and the self-contained build. So the preload build is the default if I run UI5 build. What happens now is that in the dist folder, my project is being created and the preload is being generated and minification takes place. So all the tasks, you see them also, what's happening here during the build phase are being copied. I can now use a normal web server on the build output to start it, but there is one problem with that build server now. So UI5 is not starting because it expects UI5 to be available. So it tries to load the core library or the core UI5 resource file, sub UI core.js, and it's not there. If you want to ensure that all the resources which are required are copied, then you can say minus all. This also builds now all the dependencies and copies the resources then into the dist folder for all the dependencies you have configured and needed. And then this is becoming a self-contained project. Another thing, if you would not need to have everything built locally, is to change the index.html file and point to subuiffhanaondemand.com. This might be also an option to consume it. But let's let that running and look into the other variant. So UI5 build self-contained. So in this UI5 build self-contained is quite interesting because with a self-contained build, this is one extension which we have added. We are now being able to create one single file for the application. And if I go back to that in a dist folder, I see that this is now being created also here inside. So there is a sub-UI custom.js. And this custom.js includes all the resources which are necessary for JavaScript resources, which are necessary for the application to start. And there should be no other resources from JavaScript perspective necessary. So it detects what is needed for that and includes all of them into the bundle. So let's maybe see. So when I run the self-contained build once again, then it also updates the output and I can show it in the serve. So, but I think most of you, if you have followed already some presentations of UI5 cons beforehand, then you should have seen that already live about the self-contained bundling. It's coming out of the box for this project, and it's used also to improve the loading performance because it reduces the size of the application already by half for a standard application, because our preloads are pretty coarse-grained and most of the JavaScript from the preloads are not really, really necessary here. So this is the custom bundle. So, and what it does, the self-contained build also modifies the index.html file. When you see in the index.html, the Bootstrap is adopted to include this SAP UI custom JS rather than the SAP UI core JS, and the rest of the application is then included here. No component preload, no library preload, everything comes from that. So you can try that out, give it a try. For a standard project like an application, this should be not much work. Okay. Let's talk a bit about extensibility. So as we from the UI5 team cannot develop all extensions for the UI5 tooling, we rather thought to invest into the extensibility of UI5, of this tooling, by making it possible to contribute and provide custom tasks or implement custom tasks, to implement custom middlewares for the server, or project shimming. This was something we had as an expert feature a while back, the project shimming. It's also available, but it's a bit complicated. And this project shimming allows you to consume resources or libraries which are not part of UI5. This projects, they cannot, they have no UI5 YAML information, for example, and thus the UI5 tooling doesn't know how the resources could be loaded. So with a project shim, this information can be added afterwards, but also this is more an expert feature. I would keep it away. And let's concentrate a bit on the custom tasks and custom server middlewares, because writing these custom tasks and middlewares is pretty simple. And it allows you really to extend this default functionality of the UI5 tooling. And this whole thing about this ecosystem, what I also came up on top of that, is that a while back at UI5Con, Volker approached me and asked me about, how is it, Peter, can you provide a proxy? We have no proxy for the UI5 tooling. And I said, you can develop this on your own. It's the tooling is extensible. And I hope that this worked out. So he was a bit hesitant to do it. So I said, let's prove that together. And I came to his office and we sat together really in doing a little project. That also we can really explain that we as a UI5 community can really shape the future of this development experience together. And this is also what we should do. So it should not be the task of the duty of the UI5 tooling core team to do that. It's really something we can do together to build a UI5 ecosystem, which provides a lot of nice plugins or tasks and extensions, tasks and middlewares to improve the development experience. And with that, we created a GitHub project. It's available on the public GitHub UI5 ecosystem showcase. And this UI5 ecosystem showcase includes already custom tasks to do transpilation or to do minification. It also includes middlewares, and this is especially interesting if it comes to a development experience, to have a proxy, for example, to have static content which can be served, or to do some live reloading and stuff like this. And this together, by using it, can improve the development experience already by far. And this is what I now want to do with you as an exercise here, that we really get a feeling on how modern already the CLI development experience can be with the UI5 tooling by just using these things which have been developed by the core team or which have been developed here in the community around. And there are even much more plugins and task extensions and middleware extensions available than the one who are which are listed here. And I really recommend, if you have one contributed to this ecosystem showcase, to this list here, make it available from people getting known it, and or at least keep aligned with the naming conventions, like for example saying UI5 task or UI5 middleware dash, and with that we have already a good possibility to share these features around. So what I want to do now with you is to go into the web IDE, create a project there, make it available for local development, include some custom tasks and middlewares to make or to come to a good development experience. And we really should then see and feel that how this looks like. So let's go to my web IDE. And I create a little project there, new, based on the templates, Fiori worklist application. So I say my app 123, my application, my namespace. Well, let's do it short. And from a service perspective, I just use the Northwind because it's also available for me locally. So I can use a simple proxy at the end for that. Let's say we use standalone. I'm interested in employees. The collection ID is employee ID. Let's use the last name for the title, and that's it. We don't need more. So this creates now a project based on the templates, what the UI5 team provides for the web IDE. And now I can say download, export. So I just go to my machine locally. So I have the web app here and I copy it to my community repo. So let's open the Visual Studio Code here. So first of all, when I have downloaded this project, I just look into that and see, yeah, the UI5 tooling configuration is already there and there's a lot of thing already in from the web ID. Let's keep it, I don't mind on that. But let's look into the package JSON. So the UI5 CLI is not up to date yet. It needs to be up to date also in the templates then in future. But I just use the latest one I have at, I know at the moment. And with that, I can now run an NPM install on that. So when running the NPM install, again, it's, you know that it's downloading the dependencies. And afterwards, the UI5 CLI tooling is available in my project here. And I can then start the development server for that. So UI5 serve, let's do it. And and now if I start the index.html, the first thing I notice, oops, yeah, there is one thing missing. The UI5 resources are not there. So as we could now add it as a dependency, but I want to show a bit the middlewares and the possibilities to extend now the UI5 tooling with custom middlewares to come to a better development experience on that. And so what I would do now is to enable the data source connectivity and to enable the consumption of the UI5 resources. I use now the UI5 middleware simple proxy configuration added here inside and map then these two resources. And in order to make it running, I need to now install the UI5 middleware simple proxy to my project. So with save dev, I add it as a dev dependency now. And in the package JSON, there is one speciality you should know. In order that the tooling finds it in a dependency, you should, if it's a dev dependency, you should add a UI5 dependency section and list it there. It's also explained when you go to this UI5 tooling ecosystem showcase and you go to the simple proxy, the steps how to enable that is explained also on the web page properly and on this npm.js page, and you can use this information to set that up. So by doing that, I should now be already able to run the application. So the serve is started. So index.html is there and hooray, it comes up again. And now I'm running offline and I can do now my development inside that application. I want to also showcase one thing. So because now, yeah, we could have mock data, but the UI5 is not, for example, available here. And therefore what you could do also for that is to get it from toolshanaondemand.com, download the UI5 version from there. This might be an option, extract it locally. And there is another middleware which can be used for the development. This is called serve static. So if I would include the serve static, then I can disable, for example, this one on top. And I have locally on my machine extracted the download from toolsana on demand.com, the runtime download, and use the resources content to map it also on resources again. So, and this is now providing UI5.175. Oops, what do I do? Ah, I need to install the UI5 serve static middleware. So it should be there in a second. Then I need to adopt the package JSON again. So to include this one also here. So, and when I have that, then I can start the server again. index.html, and let's see, hooray, it should work again. So, and I say SAP UI version, and I see it's now 175. So the thing is coming from my serve static, and I have now a local UI5 version, which can be used for development. There could be also other use cases for the serve static that you integrate other stuff like that, which you put somewhere else in a folder, which is not part of the UI5 resources. Maybe you overlay mock data or something like that. You can think about different approaches. It's just one thing to use and to have a possibility. So, but now I'm getting a bit, a bit lazy on that. I want to also showcase the UI5 build, and because I don't have, for example, the possibility to do and test the preloads. With that, what I typically do and what at the moment a common best practice is you can duplicate, for example, the UI5 YAML file, create a UI5 YAML dist for that. And in a dist, I talked about that a bit ago, that you can adopt the path mappings. So what you can do now is to adopt the path mapping of the web app folder to the dist folder for this UI5 YAML dist, and everything else stays the same. But I want to now check the build output, whether it also works properly, and test it with a build output. Now I can say after running the build, so everything has been moved to dist, I say UI5 serve --- config. And with that, I can specify UI5 YAML, UI5 dist YAML. And the things can be then also started from the dist folder. I see now this is the content from the dist folder. There's the component preload inside. And if I start it, you see also here in the network trace that you get now the component preload being loaded here and not the single files anymore. So it's a good choice to test also the build output. So as I said, I'm lazy. And at the moment, I hate if I do changes that I need to reload. There is a nice middleware also available, what I also recommend to use. It's the Live Reload. So maybe some of you know that already. Live Reload is a little watch task looking into the file system. It injects a little bit of script into the browser. And in any case, the file system changes. It updates and it updates the browser. So let's put it in the UI5 dist YAML. Not in a dist YAML, in the normal UI5 YAML. I want to have it for my local development. And let's install, again, the Live Reload middleware locally as a dev dependency. So this should be pretty fast again. So having the Live Reload here, I put it in here as a dependency as well. Oops. And this I don't need. And then I run the UI5 serve again. And now I see also that the Live Reload middleware is now working, and I can put the browser aside next to me. So, and when I now start developing my application, and this is what I want to have, that I can now really modify things like i18n properties. Let's say here, this is my worklist title, hello SAP community. Then it's notice that this has been changed. It updates the application, and we can even go in a routing step. And in the routing step, for example, in the object, we also modify here the semantic title. with the XXX prefix. And now you see also this is updating, it stays on the route, and you can really actively now work in the application. And if you have a good two-screen solution, you can even see immediately what has been changed and the app is updating. And this is not that we need a build to update the whole thing. So this is really, really great to get that experience. So one other thing which I would like to show is a bit an outlook on the code completion part. So it's a very rudimentary thing as a last thing for the moment to get the development experience a bit better. So at the moment we have the OpenUI5 TypeScript types available. You can install them to your project, and by then specifying a tsconfig.json file, mentioning the TS type. So I added already config.json. So here now I have the link to that. And by doing that, I already get code completion for the sub UI define. So here, now you get access to the code completion for that. So this is a basic thing already. And I also come to that a bit later that we invest in that. So having shown that, I would go back to the slides. So this was a bit like getting to the modern development experience. And you see, it's very easy to integrate all these tasks. There are more tasks available. There are things about transpiling, to use ES6 features already for developing and stuff like that. You can transpile that with that. Just look into this ecosystem showcase repository or on npm.js and the registry search for UI5 minus task minus or UI5 minus middleware minus. To get or oversee that what is available here. So let's talk a bit now about the UI5 tooling family. So basically the UI5 tooling is just the central piece. It's a very slim thing at the end, which provides all these basic aspects like projects and basic tasks for building applications, libraries, and so on. But we cannot provide all. And there are things around like the Web ID, which provide an environment to develop in. And they are using also the UI5 CLI tooling for building. There is the Business Application Studio, where I want to also go a bit further on the long run to also integrate the serve capability of the UI5 tooling to benefit also from these aspects what we have here. But there are other stuff around. There is the Karma tooling we developed in the past for testing. This also may be worth a complete separate session to talk about all these parts as well. And there is the migration tooling, which allows you to apply best practices to your code. For example, if you have old jQuery SAP requires in the code, then it can help you to modify that and bring it to sub-UI define. And there is this TypeScript topic, which we are going forward, which should improve the code completion stuff. I come to that. And also the Yeoman piece. So there are already external plugins or stuff developed, this generator ECUI5 by Marius Obert, to improve also on that level to get a kickstarting, creating projects and so on. And there is even more, which is around the scene, which can be integrated. You can use Visual Studio Code. You have the live reload, less build, whatever. There is the Express.js, and even more IDEs can be used. So the UI5 tooling is really increasing. And this is what this UI5 tooling makes it. It's open, it's extensible. Things can be put around or integrated, whatever, and used together. And this is what I really, really like on this new UI5 tooling, to benefit from all these open source toolings, to benefit from these tools and to make this one great development experience at the end. So let's come to another topic, the UI5 on NPM. So most of the people know that we have the open UI5. We saw that in the beginning, the open UI5 dependencies. And I mentioned in the UI5Con in Belgium in February this year that we are having soon a sub UI5 on NPM. And it's the case since Monday. So since Monday, sub UI5 is available on the npm.js registry. And you can go there, npmjs.com. You can look for @sub-UI5. This is the scope. And you find dependencies inside there, like all these libraries which are in. And 176 is the first version what we have there. But to consume it, we also prepared a new version of the UI5 CLI. I mentioned that on Twitter before. So UI5 CLI 2.0 is there. And thanks to the team who has done that incredible job to make it ready just in time for today, for the April 1st, the UI5 tooling 2.0, which is able to consume these dependencies properly. So, and here I want to give you some reasons behind UI5 Tooling 2.0. So the UI5 Tooling 2.0 brings several enhancements for the UI5 Tooling. It has an advanced front-end package manager, which avoids the version inconsistency. The one who have looked into the UI5 versions of the distribution layer, sub UI5 distribution layer, may have noticed that there is a version difference in the patch level between all the libraries. And the advanced package manager of the UI5 CLI tooling 2.0 exactly bridges this gap by specifying just the version of the distribution layer. It introduces a new concept in the UI5 YAML file, how to define the dependencies. So they are not maintained in the package JSON, and also npm.js states that npm is not a front-end package manager. And if there are good ideas for building front-end package managers, the individual front-end solutions should look into that. And this is what we also at the end decided after spending really a long time in investigating what is possible with npm or yarn or whatever. So, the UI5 framework dependencies, they are maintained in this UI5 YAML file in the specific framework section via either name OpenUI5 or SubUI5. Then you specify the version of the distribution and afterwards only libraries. And to make it more simple how to consume that, we invested also in new commands to make it really easy. And now let's go into my project on the command line. Which I did before. So because now I want to consume that stuff already. So I go now back to my app 1.3. So what I want to now benefit from the new UI5 tooling. So we had it in code. Let's go back to the code. And I switch now to the 2.0.1 version. So it's always a good practice to not start with 2.0.0. Most often there are some little issues inside. So if you do now npm install on that, you are prepared to have the UI5 tooling 2.0 available, and we can soon check that. So it downloads now a few pieces. Come on, faster. Now it's here. And if I say now UI5 versions, I see here the UI5 CLI is on 2.0.1 and most of the plugins are also in the 2.0 version, or no, all of the plugins are also in the 2.0 version. And now I can start using that. So in order to use that, I want to first get rid of all these dependencies I consume here via serve static and stuff like this. So this is something which I want to get differently. So I comment that out. And there is also one interesting thing. So the UI5 CLI 2.0 also changed the default encoding of the properties files to UTF-8. So this doesn't need to be explicitly maintained anymore. So only if you use ISO, which was the old default. So this can be already changed. And then you should use the spec version 2.0, because only with the spec version 2.0, the new features of the UI5 tooling 2.0 is available. Otherwise, it falls back to the old behavior and doesn't recognize the framework and stuff like that. So having this done now, I can say UI5 use, and then I say SAP UI5 at 176.0. It doesn't mind whether it's upper or lowercase. So now, if I look into my UI5 YAML file, I see it has added for me already this framework section. And now I need to say, yeah, UI5 add, I want to add dependencies to that. So the core library is interesting, M library, SAP F library, and the theme lib sub Fury 3. So I do that, and it adds for me now these libraries. So that should be all for me. And now I can say UI5 serve. And what happens now is that behind the scenes, the UI5 tooling is downloading these dependencies for me, because we don't need to download it in the npm install phase. And I can now run the application. It's starting up and it's consuming this centrally managed from the UI5 frontend package manager, centrally managed dependencies to these tools. And this also saves tremendously time. It avoids redundancies of these dependencies in the project. And the performance overall is also much better, because it does it only on demand than building or surfing. So with that, you are already good to go now to use the 2.0 version of the tooling for your project. One other thing I would like to mention is that, yeah, many of you might have fallen into the trap that they made some mistakes in the YAML file. I introduced now here one in that one. And if I now start, for example, the surf again, it recognizes that there is an issue and it prints them out. So there is an after SA middleware, which it doesn't know, and helps me to explain to me what is wrong. And this validation is pretty nice to, in future, not run into issues where you search for a while, whether it's an indentation issue or a typo or whatever. So this is something we also invested because it cost us also a lot of time in the past. So this is all about tooling 2.0. I hope we did not promise too much and you are really happy with that, what is there. Please play around with that, give feedback on that. I think it will also help to improve the overall development experience. So one other thing now to really prove that I can consume the sub-UI5 dependency, I want to add now the sub-suite UI microchart dependency to that. So let's go back to that UI5 add sub-suite UI microchart. So adding that, it added the framework dependency. Now I need to go to my little notebook to grab you a bit of code, because the microchart code I want to embed now in the app. So let's go there and go to this one here. I think I need to restart it once again. Let's go to Visual Studio Code, because I made changes in the configuration. Here is the app. So let's go to the object view, which we see now. And in the object view, we add the content, the semantic content. And here I add the microchart, and I hope I did it right. I missed one thing that was clear. I need to add the XML namespace mapping for the microchart. So, and with that now, hooray, the microchart is there, coming from the sub-UI5 distribution layer. Cool. So, but now, that's it to the tooling 2.0, what I wanted to show. Let's see what else. So I have a few things I also want to mention here. So you have seen already, or I talked a bit about Yeoman. You have seen the templates in the web IDE. And now the templates are also available via Yeoman generator, what you have in the web IDE. You can use them directly also from npm.js. You can install the sub-UI5 or generate the sub-UI5 templates locally on your machine. And then afterwards, so let's go into make the Yeoman test. You can now use then the generator here, Yo add sub-UI5, sub-UI5 minus templates, to create your project based on one of these three templates. So let's say Yeoman, just call it Yo namespace. Now I can select one of these templates. You say the title of the app, the description, then standalone, the service, say I use the Northwind service, I have pre-configured it, the destination, the data source URL used in the manifest and for the proxying. And then you specify the collection name and the collection ID. So that's what you know from the web IDE at the end, also what you input there. Then with that, you have the Yeoman created locally. You can run npm install. And after npm install, it's not the UI5 tooling 2.0 yet here inside the templates. This needs to be updated soon. So, but you can now use UI5 serve minus O index HTML from here to start it. And then this is the application which we have now scaffolded. It's the employees app, and I can also click here. Here I have the whole thing running as well. Then what else? The TypeScript definitions. We have seen briefly about the OpenUI5 TypeScript definitions. They are pretty old at the moment, so with 160, what we have available here. But I can just give you already a brief sneak preview on that we are soon about to release for sub-UI5 in general, the TypeScript definition. They are still a bit tricky to be used. They have errors inside, but we are at the moment working on that to get that cleaned up. But we want to really make this a standard process that for the shipment of UI5, we also want to ship the TypeScript definitions for that and improve step by step over the next releases the quality of that, because it helps us to get a basic code completion for UI5 development. It's usable for the Business Application Studio to get the code completion running for that. It's usable for you locally then. And it brings me also to one next topic, which I want to give you as a last thing, as an outlook, the what's next. Because we are really also interested in working on to come to a different way of developing UI5 apps. With a modern environment, with a real modern environment, having TypeScript you can use then for the UI5 development, which is then being converted into JavaScript for sure, which is then being converted into UI5. So there are already solutions out there which doing that. We can use Babel for that to do that. And together with the TypeScript definitions files, which helps you to use it to then write TypeScript based UI5 or modules for UI5, you will then get really a more modern development experience based on this Babel toolchain, which we can integrate then in via the extensibility in the UI5 tooling to make this possible. Some of you might have used already open source projects because they exist already. It's something which we are also interested in, to make this possible, to explain that also how it works, and to support that also by providing the proper TypeScript definitions from the UI5 perspective. So I have a disclaimer here, because this is really, really what's next. And it's no warranty at the moment what the timeline for that looks like. We are discussing that and we are working on that. But at the end goal should be more or less that you can write import, export based syntax. So maybe I have it here still. I just tried to sketch it, but I did not complete yet on that. Code.
Hey, Peter, in the meanwhile, I think I will show the poll, because we are really coming to the end of our session. So I will launch a poll, everyone, and we want you to answer the questions in there. And we also saw that there are a lot of questions here in the chat and in the Q&A. We will keep all those together. We will update them. And Peter will publish a blog post soon and would try his best to include all these questions in there. So, as I said, we will have topic of the month in April is SAP UI5, and there we will publish the blog post including all your questions. And the poll is now open, so kindly ask you to answer the questions there.
Okay, cool. Thanks, Svea, for that. Because I'm also really, really close to the end now. Basically, it's to come into the perspective that you can really use imports, exports, you can class definitions and stuff like that. So all that should be possible using also TypeScript and so on. This is what we are working on as well, to get that done by supporting that with that, what is really, really necessary for that. And then I hope that we as a community can shape this development experience together to come really to something like this as well. And that's basically it from my side. It's just the outlook. There are a lot of resources. I think we will share the slides afterwards. Svea, I don't know whether I upload it somewhere or how we do it.
Of course, yeah. The slides and as well as the recording will be uploaded on our SAP Community Calls page. I will paste here the link again. And as I said, also when you open the SAP Community homepage, the topic of the month will be SAP UI5, so you can find all information here as well. And Peter, I will also put your subcommunity profile link into the chat.
Okay, thank you.
So people can follow you.
Once we are interested, we put here also the QR code for Margot and me, so you can even scan it now fast. Thanks, Svea, for the hint.
Yeah, no problem. So it's 2 minutes before 5 o'clock. I think it makes sense not to answer any question, because then we come from one to one and it will be too much time. So I ask everyone to wait for the presentation and for the recording, which will be published as soon as possible. And it was a really nice discussion here in the chat. So thanks everyone for being part of the call. Thanks to you, of course, Peter and Margot.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, she answered already a lot of questions. So what is a great call.
Okay.
So thanks everyone. And hopefully we hear each other soon in one of the next calls.
Yeah, thanks so much for having us here. I really enjoyed it. And let's also in future continue on that. I think it's a very nice channel to give our insight also to the outside and also motivate we as a community to do a lot of things together here.
Yeah, perfect. Thanks very much. Bye.
Bye. Thank you.